Color grading does not have to take you ages. In this video, I'm going to show you 5 pro tips for beginner colorists that you can use to speed up your workflow, get a great image, and get that project out the door for the world to see. So there'll be plenty of projects where you'll have footage from different cameras and sources, and you'll need them to match somewhat, or otherwise they'll stick out in the edit like a sore thumb and be super distracting to the viewer. When it's from the same camera under the same lighting conditions, that's easy. Copy and paste the grade. But what do you do when that's not the case? Well, you can use the image wipe function. First up, find the image that you want to reference, i.e. the one that you're trying to match to. Right click and select create still. That will save a still of the frame, including the grade information up in the gallery section. Next, navigate to the shot that you want to change to match the still that you've just taken. Once you do, you can select the image wipe up here, and once active, you'll have the ability to wipe between them so you can compare. There's a few different options for how the image wipe is displayed along this top toolbar. For me, I tend to use the traditional horizontal wipe, but play around and see what works for you. And it's not just by eye that you get to compare these two images. You can see that as we're wiping across the image, it's showing up in our scopes. So we can use this to bring the luminance and color balance levels in line with each other. And while we're at it, here's another quick tip that's not even part of the real 5 in this video. So turn on the qualifier focus tool in your scopes so that when you mouse over your image, you can have the area highlighted in your scopes. Super handy. You know what else is super handy? This video is brought to you by Envato, the unlimited creative subscription. The broadest range of categories, everything that you need to make great videos. Follow the link in the description and start creating now. Next up, we're going to look at how to get fast contrast boosts with custom curves and not with the contrast slider. Most beginners will look at this contrast slider in the primary's color wheels and just crank that bad boy up, crushing all the details in the process, the same with the saturation. But although they look like a quick fix, you'll spend way more time trying to fix mistakes you've made using them than actually creating your grade, potentially. Curves give better control over the contrast in your image and a more polished, professional look, and it's like a couple of extra clicks. Let's suppose we've done a super basic primaries correction here with our lift, gamma, and gain, only focusing on the luminance and not on our color at all. We can then head over to the curves tab, and in the custom curves, the first one on the list, we'll create a little S curve to introduce some contrast. Make sure for this step you have the YRG and B channels linked and active. That's luminance and color, just FYI. On the bottom left of the graph, drag the point to the right ever so slightly and do the inverse with the top point. That pulls the blacks and the white parts of the image away from the extreme margins and just gives us a little bit of room to play with. Then look at the graph, which is a histogram, and you can tell that by switching to the histogram scope. You'll note the similar shape. And if you mouse over the image now that we have the qualifier focus turned on, you'll see that the scope is showing the darker parts of the image to the left and the brighter parts to the right. So with that information now in mind, you're going to basically create an S-curve that makes the dark parts darker and the bright parts brighter, thus increasing the contrast between the two. We'll then create a midpoint in our S-curve where our midtones are sitting just to control those a little bit further and bring it to eye, and that's our contrast done. Now we need to add a little saturation. Let's move over to the Luma versus Sat curve and start adding some points and increasing the saturation where we see fit. And as you do this, you'll see that it is much better to do this here with control over what parts of the image that you want to saturate versus the single slider that just globally saturates everything. So then just to finish up with our saturation, we can go to the Hue versus Saturation tab and use our qualifier on the image to click the parts that we want to decrease or increase. So if we have a certain color that's just popping way too much, click it, create a point, then decrease that saturation. Same goes for anything that we want to increase the saturation on. Now, as for this example, I've done it in one node. It's going to be really easy for us to compare the slightly more in-depth process that we've just done with the quick single slider version. So let's create a new node here, go back to our primaries and crank some contrast and saturation into the image globally. Then we'll compare the two and you can see just how kind of rough or bad the quick one is. And you'll start to get an idea of how long it might take to correct those global adjustments versus the little bit of work that we've done in the curves tab that have got us to a really nice point. It's only a few more tools, a few more clicks. Moving on. Natural skin tone is crucial, but it can also be a bit of a pain. There's plenty of ways to work skin in DaVinci Resolve, but let's look at this quick hack that I've been using recently for tweaking skin tones. Create a new serial node with Option S or right clicking. It is crucial to have this next step in a separate node, so make sure you set this up first. We're then going to use the qualifier tool to select our skin tone, and we can make sure that we're seeing that selection by turning on this button up here. Then back in our qualifier tab, we can just adjust the selection as best we can to try and isolate only the skin in our image. You can use a combination of the HSL sliders on the left and the matte finesse sliders on the right. Once you're happy with the selection, turn off the highlight so that you're seeing the full image again. Right-click on the node that we've made the skin selection in, go down to Gamma, and change that to Linear. Now go to your primary's color wheels, and in the gain wheel, importantly just the gain wheel, you can now move that around and adjust your skin tone globally. The slower, more traditional way is to not switch the layer gamma to linear, and then you just play with the skin tone across all three primary's color wheels. However, if you've done this before, you know it can be slightly touchy and also can be a little bit difficult to get a very specifically nice image. You can go too far very quickly. But with this linear gamma method, you have way more margin to play with. And if you turn on your vectorscope as well, you can make sure that you're adjusting to the skin tone line. This is going to be a really good way to quickly tweak your skin tones, and then you can use all the other skin tone tools to really dial that in. Moving on. Now, if you have a timeline with a whole bunch of different media on it, chances are it may have sections that are all from one camera, but it chopped up into many multitude of different little clips, like an interview, for example. Instead of going through each clip in the color tab and either grading them all individually or rather copy and pasting the grade across them all, which admittedly I've been in the habit of doing and have also demonstrated on this very channel in the past, what you can do instead is over in the edit tab, you can create an adjustment clip. Go to your effects, toolbox, and search for adjustment clip. Once you've created the clip, just sit it atop all of the clips that you want to target. So for instance, all of these interview clips here, and then you can go into the color page and create your grade on the single adjustment clip layer, and it will be applied to all of those clips below. Super simple. And finally, on a similar note, if you're often working with similar footage in similar locations, such as recording pieces to camera for a YouTube channel in the same room under the same lighting conditions, then chances are you're grading those clips each and every time you shoot a new project. But you don't need to be doing that. You can create something called a power grade. So if you're familiar with the concept of grading a clip, then grabbing a still from it, and then applying that grade from the still across a range of other clips in your project, then the power grade function is basically exactly the same thing. However, that still or power grade will be available to you in every single project. So let's say that you have your grade absolutely dialed in for this piece to camera setup. In your gallery section, make sure you're in the power grades tab, then you can right click and grab your still. Then next time you open up a new project, that grade will be waiting there for you, and all you need to do is apply it to your footage. And if you apply it to your rushes right from the very start, before you even start cutting it up, by the time you get to the polish pass of your edit, your grade will be halfway done. How good is that? So there you go, that's 5 pro tips for fast color grading that you can employ as a beginner colorist to speed up your workflow and get that video finished ASAP. And speaking of speeding up your workflow, this video is of course brought to you by Envato, your one-stop shop for all of your creative asset needs. To learn more about Envato and the unlimited downloads that you get of millions of high-quality creative assets, click the link in the description below. And until next time, keep it saturated.